Hej och välkomna till öppna föreläsningar här i Fysikcom i Stockholm universitet. Här är den första öppna föreläsningen för året 2021 till 2022. Och idag vi har glad det här Igor Pikovsky. Han är assistant professor här i Stockholm universitet. Och jag försöker att bidra Igor. Igor har fått hans doktorexamen i Wien, universitet i Österrike. Och sen efter den han flyttat till USA. Och han har varit forskare i Harvard University i Cambridge. Och sen efter den han blivit assistant professor i Stevens Institute of Technology i New Jersey, också i USA. Men sen Igor har flyttat till Sverige. Han har blivit bidragande lektor och forskare här i Fysikum. Och Igor forskar med kvantteori, kvantoptomekanik och hur man kan koppla kvantteori till gravity och också tillämpning till nya området här, kvantteknologi. Och igår, idag pratar jag om, på engelska idag, men from quantum mystery to quantum technologies. Igor, the floor is yours.
Ja, tack så mycket, Mohamed. Tack. Så, så jag ska prata på engelska. Jag tror det är bättre för alla. Min svenska är inte så bra om vi pratar om fysik. So we'll switch to English, thanks a lot for tuning in. And so this is just a small introduction that I want to give about talking about what's actually special about quantum mechanics. The title of the talk is From Quantum Mysteries to Quantum Technologies. What it captures is that for many decades, people have studied and wondered about what really is special about quantum mechanics, what makes it different from other aspects of physics that we know, and it ranges from mathematical structures all the way even to philosophical questions. But today there is a very exciting development of these type of questions where we start leveraging it for actually new technologies. So the 21st century will be seeing a lot of developments on this frontier, which will have a deep impact on society as a whole. Many different ways. And so we went a long way from philosophical questions now towards commercialization of quantum physics, and then even into hopefully positive deep impact on society with the development of new technologies. Here we go. So the deep question about quantum mechanics and how it was developed was trying to understand how the world looks like at very small scales. And the reason for that was that we had some conceptual questions at the end of the 19th century, but nobody could predict really the revolution that was coming about with the development of quantum physics. But there were some experiments we did, and you know, some things just didn't work out the way that we imagined things would look like. Kind of our basic picture of the small world is quite similar actually of how the large world looks like. So here on the right-hand side, you can see solar system with a couple of our planets. And deep down, how we imagine physics looks like is it's made out of atoms, and they have some resemblance to these big structures. And the reason for that is there is a deep reason, of course. And the reason for that is that the forces that bind these systems together look very similar. On the one hand, we have electric forces, and they're governed by Coulomb's law, which depends on the charges we have and on the distance. And on the large scales, we are mostly governed by gravity. And that force of nature mathematically looks very similar. We have gravitational charges, the masses, and they depend on one over distance squared, the Newtonian law. And so this is why the structures that appear are somewhat similar. But that's not the whole story. If you just think about forces, you know, there could be variations of that, but you wouldn't see something which is much deeper. Namely, what's special about the quantum world is that the very nature, the very basic principles that govern our physical world are completely different than what we expect and are used to from our everyday scales. And this is really what's special about quantum mechanics. It's not so much that it changes the forces with which we interact, although it also does that, but it's rather that the very basic notions of reality change in the quantum world. So what's different in the quantum world? And the three basic concepts that really are the main pillars of what's special, I'm going to summarize here and say a few words about it in this evening lecture. So on the one hand, what's truly different in the quantum world from anything else that we've known so far and since is that it's inherently uncertain. And it's not just simply that there is some probabilities or uncertainty, but rather that it's irreducibly probabilistic. And that means that these probabilities have no underlying reason. So there's no way to get rid of them. So this uncertainty, quantum uncertainty, is some very fundamental aspect. It seems to be a very fundamental aspect of nature and the universe as we know it. Now, another specialty of quantum mechanics are so-called superpositions. To capture what that is, in some sense, this is a more broader class and a rich form of existence. So there are certain ways that quantum systems can exist and behave, which do not appear on everyday scales. So it's a more broader class of what quantum systems even can be. And then finally, the third part, which is very special about quantum mechanics, is what we call entanglement. And entanglement captures correlations between different quantum systems. And these correlations are also unlike anything else that we could possibly imagine on everyday scales. So these are three very special fundamental pillars of the quantum weirdness. And what's also interesting is that we flipped it around after now many decades of studying it, and we use these fundamental strangeness and pillars to actually build something new, to leverage them. And so quantum technology is the field that tries to control these phenomena and then leverage them for just novel applications and practical uses. So just a few words on quantum technologies. What is the promise of them? And that is really to harness this novel behavior at small scales. And we harness it by really precisely controlling and manipulating quantum effects in the laboratory. So initially it started off as a theoretical question, mathematical question, what kind of measurements and what kind of tools can we engineer? And then experimentalists start building them, such as Mohamed himself, who just introduced me, experimental physicist in quantum optics and quantum information science, actually can implement many of these techniques to study and control individual quantum systems, such as atoms, photons, and electrons. And the reason it's special is because it allows us to really harness these strange effects that we're going to talk about. And just as a kind of very brief, to start with, as a brief take-home message about quantum technologies, it's not so much that they do something better, although in many cases they do in some special applications, but it's more that these quantum technologies are just fundamentally different. So just to give you an example, a laser is not a better light bulb. It does not replace a light bulb, but it can do specific tasks which are simply impossible to do with normal everyday light sources. And so this is true for all quantum technologies that we're developing. They really open the door for completely novel applications. Okay, but let me, before we talk a little bit about the technology sector, let me first dive in into these conceptual questions about what's truly different about the quantum world. And in the rest, the next 20 minutes or so, or half an hour, I'll go through these different aspects and just try to at least give a little feel of what it means that we have these specific underlying concepts of nature that seems to be how truly nature works, and that we know from quantum mechanics. So first, let's talk a little bit about this fundamental irreducible uncertainty. Okay, so we started off with this picture where we had an atom. So I think everybody is familiar with this picture. You have a core, a nucleus of the atom, and then electrons that are going around it because they're held together by electric forces. And the truth is that this picture is convenient, but it's not the real story in some sense. And it's wrong in many ways, which relate to this notion of probabilities. So what's truly special about quantum mechanics is there's no such thing as some very definite and predefined notions of reality, what we say. Or in other words, properties that we're used to, such as position, color, just any properties that we could measure or define objects in everyday world. In the quantum world, most of the time, these properties are actually just random. And what quantum mechanics does is it makes predictions about this randomness. It tells us how random it is and how it can change. So in reality, in some sense, these electrons are not simply somewhere in a specific localized position. The only thing we can say, and the only thing they truly are in some sense, is that they're actually distributed in some way, and we can only say that with some probability they have to be found somewhere in this region. So this blue region is one electron, and this yellow region is another electron, and they signify here just probabilities of where they could potentially be. And that is really inherently always true for quantum mechanics, and not just simply in our description, but really how nature behaves. So what is strange about it? So, you know, I said that this is one of these kind of maybe biggest mysteries of quantum mechanics, that it is this, has this probabilistic nature. Now, probabilities per se, of course, we're very used to, and we use them all the time. And it's very powerful ways to talk about reality around us, such as the weather forecast, for example. You know, everybody knows that it can change. And there are some probabilities that we use in order to, you know, it can be good for a while, and then after a while, we just don't know. Stock markets is a prime example of probabilities. We have no way of predicting where it's going to go. And of course, even in physics, probabilities play a fundamental role. Statistical physics, thermodynamics, such as temperature, these are all probabilistic concepts. So there's nothing special about the probability notion per se. But how we usually understand probabilities is because something is just so complex, has so many moving parts, that we just have no way to explain or predict how it's going to behave in the next instant of time. So such as the stock market, there is just so many different people involved, psychologists and news, that there's hardly any possibility to predict where it's going to go next. Or when we talk about temperatures, there's just so many atoms involved and they jiggle around, we can't keep track of all of them. And that's why we use probabilities. But inherently, everything is following laws of nature, which are deterministic. And so if we had a way, some computer or something that could really keep track of all the individual parts, there's nothing stopping us from predicting where it's going to be next. But that notion has to be abandoned in quantum mechanics. In quantum mechanics, these probabilities have completely different nature. They're not because we just don't know exactly what's happening because it's so complex. But there's really no reason. There's no underlying reason for why these probabilities occur. There's nothing, there's not a lack of information. They're just inherently and fundamentally irreducible. So they're just always there, and it seems to be that this is how nature operates. The first to realize that was actually Einstein in the 20s. So he's well known also to be somebody who was so-called wrong about quantum mechanics because he didn't like it. But he was also deeply right about it because he was the first to realize what's really strange about it. So he had this famous quote about that God doesn't play dice. And what he meant is that this inherent probabilistic nature just cannot be the full story. There has to be something that explains it. But today we know that this is not possible. And it's experiments, there's very clever experiments that can show that there's no way to get rid of this probabilistic nature of quantum mechanics. And so that's one of these deep mysteries of nature, that we just have to accept that some things are just not predetermined. So let me illustrate what is meant by these probabilities by what we do as theorists, which are so-called Gedanken experiments. What Gedanken experiments do is we imagine some scenario as if you're doing an experiment, idealized way, in order to think it through and see what the theory predicts for us. And so this thought experiment, as a translation to English, that we're going to look at is the following. So it's a you know, an imaginary scenario where we deal with billiard balls. And now these billiard balls, what's important for us is that they can have two different properties. One property is color, so they can get different colors, you know, like orange, yellow, blue, and so forth. And the other property is the filling, so they can be full or they can be half filled. So these are two properties that are important for us here. Now, let's for simplicity only focus on two colors, just to make it simpler. Namely, we assume the billiard balls can only be blue or red. And so we have four distinct probabilities. They can be blue or red, and at the same time, they can be also filled or half filled. So these are the possible billiard balls that we can have. And so the Gedanken experiment is very simple. So imagine you have a bucket of these balls, and they're described by quantum mechanics. And in this bucket, you have many, many balls, and they have all these, you know, they're random how we fill them. So they can be fully filled or half filled and can have different colors. This experiment consists of three steps. The first step is let's remove all red balls. Okay, so we reach into the bucket, we look at all the red balls and just take them out. Okay, so then this is how it would look like. We have only blue balls left. Now, the second step is that we remove all balls which have filling, namely, we remove all fully filled balls. So we reach in, look at them, and we remove these two remaining balls here. Okay. And so then we have only these balls remaining. We removed all the red ones and we removed all the filled ones. Now the third step is just very simple. Now we just check what we have left inside the bucket. And now the special thing about quantum mechanics is what we find is this. We find that some of the balls that we are measuring in this bucket actually are also red. So these red balls reappear even though we have removed them completely initially. And this has nothing to do with not being exact. You know, we can make sure that initially we really look at all the balls exactly which color they have. And no matter how good we do that, in the end, when we reach in, some of the balls will be red again. And so this is something that captures some of these very strange properties of quantum mechanics that we don't have any intuition for of how this can be. And how we talk about it in the quantum language is that some properties of systems are complementary to each other. And what it means is that in our case, we had two properties we looked at, the color and the filling of the billiard balls. And if these properties are complementary, then by specifying one of these properties, we introduce complete uncertainty about the other properties. So even if he initially had removed all the red balls, after we look at the filling, we have reintroduced full uncertainty about whether the balls are red or blue. And this is inherent to the system. So even though we think we removed all the red ones, these balls reappear to be red because they become uncertain again. And in other words, complementarity means that we cannot know simultaneously two different properties about the system and precisely specify. So if we try, then we actually erase the knowledge about the other and the system start to change again. So that's this inherent probability of quantum mechanics. And of course, one manifestation of complementarity is the famous so-called Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which talks about very specific properties such as position and velocity. But it's a fundamental notion about many, many properties of quantum systems. And it's a way to see this quantum uncertainty in action. So this uncertainty can never disappear. Okay, so that's just a few words about this part. Also just to illustrate that our everyday intuition is not working. Even though we can come up with millions of reasons why they reappear, and all these reasons have to do with something that we didn't do something right, in the end, we can control for all of them, and it will never work. It will always be such that this uncertainty reappears. Okay, and the second strange or special property about quantum mechanics are these superposition states. And as I said here, this is a more rich class of forms of existence that we don't see actually in everyday world. So what is a good way to think about superpositions? One way we visualize it is when we do experiments, and superpositions have a signature that they show us. And the signature is what we call interference. So if we had systems like classical, when we say classical, we mean everyday scales, normal balls that obey normal physics, not quantum physics. And we do a specific experiment. One example is we shoot these balls through a wall where it has two holes in it, like here. Then the signature of them on the other side is they line up behind these holes where we shoot the particle from. They're blocked by these walls completely. But interference is the phenomenon that, which is usually associated with waves, so also everyday scales with waves, but not with systems like balls, is that when it appears behind the wall, it doesn't just show two stripes, but instead it can come at different spots, which are behind this wall. And these different spots could be far away and not necessarily behind these holes where we see them. And this is called interference, and this is called the interference pattern, where you have a big concentration of systems and then nothing, and then again big concentration and then nothing, and so forth. And this signature is of a property that we know as superposition. And colloquially, we say that sometimes that these systems go at the same time through both slits, because that's the only way to explain how this pattern arises. But that's, again, just a failure of our intuition. They don't go at the same time through both slits. Rather, they exhibit a certain form of existence for which we don't have a good intuition. So it's not just simply they can go through one slit or the other slit. They can also go through superposition of both slits. And that's perfectly valid to do in the quantum world in nature. And in fact, we can see that in many, many experiments, and it's for decades. And here, I'm just going to give you one nice demonstration that has been performed at the University of Vienna. So in this movie, you see how single molecules are shot from such a little molecule cannon through a double slit, and then record. So what you can see here is that, oops. So what you see here is that each dot represents a single molecule which is recorded on the screen, one by one, and they appear randomly on the screen, at random positions. So that captures this randomness. These dots that appear are just one by one molecules that come and arrive after when we go to a double slit. And after a while, after recording many and many, we see that they actually together collectively form a pattern, and this pattern has many stripes. So there's one, two, three, four stripes, not just two. So that captures really this notion of superposition, that these molecules exhibit a behavior which is impossible to see on large scales, such as with billiard balls. So what can be in superposition? So when we talk about these superpositions, it opens a whole class of new possible behavior in the quantum world. But it seems mysterious to us. But the question, of course, arises, which systems can be in superposition, which cannot be? But the honest answer is that anything in nature can in principle be in superposition. There's nothing in quantum mechanics or in nature that prohibits, as far as we know, systems to exhibit superposition, even large objects and everyday objects. We just usually don't see it and have no way yet to create such forms of existence. So the most famous example, of course, trying to show the absurdity of it, is the so-called Schrödinger cat, where Schrödinger imagined that if you translate this notion of superposition into everyday life, then certain properties, like being alive, could be in a superposition where there is kind of a combination of being alive and not alive. And here the example here is you have a box and inside of it you have a toxic poison, which is released if and only if there is a quantum system that is decaying. And so this decaying quantum system can exhibit superpositions, and then it percolates into this whole apparatus, creating this macroscopic poor cat to kind of experience this form of existence. But he used it as a Gedanken experiment also just simply to show that it's just absurd to think about it. But since then, we came a long way. And so far, as far as we know, there is actually nothing fundamentally from prohibiting the scenario to take place. It's just very, very hard to create the scenario and to keep these superpositions to exist for a long time. But that's what a lot of experiments are trying to do. So one example where superpositions are not strange at all, and we are very used to them, is actually polarization of light. So that's a property that we can observe and that we also know exists, which is very natural, and their superpositions do exist and are observed and are part of our everyday experience. So what is polarization of light? We know, of course, light can have different colors, wavelengths, and these are electromagnetic waves, but it has an additional property, which, you know, I guess many are familiar with, which is called polarization. Polarization just simply tells us how this electromagnetic wave, how the electric and magnetic part, how they relate to each other as it oscillates. And we distinguish between vertical and horizontal polarization, depending on the direction of propagation, if it's vertical with respect to it or horizontal. But then light can also have what's known as circular polarization, which is a combination of both. And so it would look like that, where the strength of these electric and magnetic fields actually rotate as it propagates and not just oscillate. And this circular polarization is, in fact, a superposition of both of these properties. And we write it down usually in this form, where it could be either vertical or horizontal. So these brackets correspond to this kind of form of existence that a system can be in. So it could be vertical or horizontal. And it could also be circular, which it turns out is just a combination of both of these vertical and horizontal ones. It's basically a sum of them, or the difference between them. And so what does it mean? You are familiar probably with polarizing glasses, sunglasses. They block light. And in particular, what you see here are three polarizers. So if you have two polarizers and they are exactly perpendicular to each other, then what comes out there is nothing. So they block out one polarization, and the one perpendicular one blocks out the other polarization, and then it's completely dark. But if you put in between a polarizer which is not perpendicular to them, but it's at 45 degrees, then what that one does is it actually blocks off this combination instead. But at the same time, it doesn't just simply completely block and absorb the light, but it also rotates the polarization into this particular form. And so what this type of simple experiment shows is that the polarization that comes out after going through a polarizer, which is circular, what comes out is it has, again, a component which is both vertical and horizontal. So even if you block out completely the vertical component, after inserting the circular component, we don't just block, but we also create this light that comes out, which has to be polarized circular, which means it has both components, again, a vertical and horizontal. This is one, that's why you get a little bit more brighter spot if you insert it in between. So this is just a simple example to say that some superpositions actually are not strange. So it's not so much that all of superpositions are some kind of esoteric weird effect of quantum mechanics. No, it just depends on what we experience in everyday life. And so polarization is maybe not something we experience all the time, but there's nothing special about it. We can create polarizing glasses. And so some superpositions persist, and we have, there's nothing strange about them. And so these other forms of existence can be perfectly fine. So in other words, it just depends on what we are used to experiencing. And so some superpositions we're used to, and then we have maybe some intuition for it, and others we just never see in everyday scales. And that's why they seem to us so unnatural or strange. But according to quantum mechanics, any superposition is allowed. And the reason we don't usually see it is because it's extremely hard to isolate them. Namely, they're very, very, very fragile. So if these systems that have superpositions in any way interact with anything around them, then these superpositions typically are lost. And this is what's known as decoherence. And so the whole trick is to try and isolate them and control them in such a way that we can maintain them for a while. And this is what a lot of experimental physicists are doing and keep pushing the boundaries. But it becomes much harder the bigger the systems. But polarization is an example where they do persist for forever, which is because polarization does not interact with this surrounding. So these superpositions are perfectly preserved, and there's nothing strange around. So maybe sometime in the future, maybe centuries from now, creating and maintaining superpositions of even very strange, very unusual states could be the norm. And then this is different types of, you know, kind of forms of matter or existence that we have not experienced so far. Okay, so this is just a couple of words on uncertainty, superposition, and finally, the last crucial thing which is truly different about the quantum world is what's known as entanglement. These are superior correlations that we do not experience otherwise. And it's inherently linked to the notion of superposition and the notion of uncertainty. So entanglement wouldn't be able to exist without either one of those other two. So let's again think a little bit through a possible Gedanken experiment just to illustrate what entanglement is and why it's different from what we usually experience. So what we said initially is that measuring quantum systems give us probabilistic outcomes. So it's like playing the lottery in some sense when we measure a system. Quantum mechanics tells us exactly what the probabilities are of the different lottery tickets. But in the end, when we do an experiment, we have to repeat it many times in order to gather the probabilities of the outcomes. So for example, let's say we measure again our billiard balls, and we measure if it's blue or red. So 50% of the time, if you again have a bucket maybe, and we have these systems that are blue or red, 50% of the time we'll measure the system to be blue, and 50% of the time we'll measure it to be red. So we can perform an experiment. We can, you know, take a billiard ball and then just measure, is it red or blue? Okay. And what we do, we just record the outcomes and then we repeat it. So we take a billiard ball, we measure if it's red or blue, and then we take the next one, we measure if that is red or blue, and so forth. And then we just make a list. So we record the outcomes. So it's a very, very simple scenario. Okay. So let's say the first try, we measure it and we record that it was blue. Okay. Then the second ball we take, we record that it's red. Let's say the third one we take, and it could be blue again. It's just random. And then again, on the fourth try, it's also blue. And on the fifth try, it's red. So that just captures the fact that quantum mechanics is probabilistic. Now, to understand the notion of entanglement, we need a second system. Okay. So if you take two quantum systems, and we have a second one, we can perform exactly the same type of experiment. So again, we just simply look at if the system we're looking at is red or it's blue. And we do exactly the same. We just record the outcomes of the system and look at what's happening. Okay, so we can do that. So on the first try, we look at this system, it's blue, on the second try, it's red, and so forth. And if you just look at this list individually, it's completely random. Okay, so it could be random if it's blue or red, and we can go on, we can make, you know, 500 tries and so forth. We can make statistics out of it. We'll see it's just 50% one and 50% the other. So it's a completely random thing, like throwing a dice. And true also for the other system. But if you look closely, there is something special going on. Namely, between these two lists, you can see that individually, they perfectly match. So even though individually the full list is completely random and this one is completely random, they're actually always exactly the same. So the randomness of both of them becomes correlated with each other. So in other words, it's a bit as if you are throwing one dice and we are throwing another dice, which could be arbitrarily far away. And if you throw the dice, it could come any random number between 1 and 6 on it. And it's true also for the second dice. But then later when we compare what we have actually thrown, they will be always perfectly correlated. And this perfect correlation, no matter where they are, of randomness, is what we call a quantum entanglement. And there's no way to explain it with notions of everyday physics. The only way everyday physics can explain it is that somehow these dice communicate with each other. Somehow they know about each other. Somehow they can, you know, they're connected by something that we don't see. But in quantum mechanics, that's not the case. They're not connected. They could be arbitrary far away. There's even no way to know if our dice is entangled to something else on the other end of the universe, because all we can see is just randomness. It's only if we compare it, whatever randomness somebody else has recorded, that we see that it could be perfectly correlated. And this perfect correlation of randomness is what we call entanglement. So that was this final strange aspect of quantum mechanics, which is truly different from our everyday experience and even the laws of physics as we knew it until quantum mechanics came along. So this is a brief summary just of these three features. There's more features, but these are really the core from which a lot of other things follow. One is it's intrinsically random. So none of the properties in nature, they're not definite. They cannot be pre-labeled and we need to discover them. Instead, they're just inherently random. And we cannot get rid of this randomness, even if you wanted to. The second part is that they can exhibit quantum superpositions. So the superpositions are somewhat similar to waves, but they correspond to individual quantum particles. So individual molecules, atoms, and in fact, it doesn't have even any size limit. And it seems that they're simultaneously in these different states, but this superposition state is kind of a different form of how they can behave. And finally, the third aspect is that the correlation of randomness, and this is what we call entanglement. And these could be correlations between two or even more particles. And if you just look at them individually, there's nothing we can learn about entanglement. Everything is completely random, as it would be for an isolated system. But when we look at their correlation between each other, then we'll see that it comes about through this intrinsic correlation of randomness, no matter how far away these particles are. So these are the three fundamental properties that make the quantum world different from our everyday experience. Okay, and now the second part that I want to talk briefly about is kind of a positive aspect about it. So this so far was somewhat even philosophical or conceptual. This is really what quantum theory, quantum mechanics boils down to. But now what we can do is we can talk about how this can actually be flipped around and whether we can do something useful. And that is the field of quantum technology, which exploits these strange behavior and tries to control them in order to create novel applications. And quantum technology has also three main fields so far. On the one hand, one field is called quantum communication. And fundamentally, what quantum communication does, it leverages probabilities. So the fact that quantum systems are inherently probabilistic is used here in the context of quantum communication to create fundamentally secure cryptography. So to encode information and encode information transfer that cannot be cracked in any way because it uses this fundamental notion of probabilities of quantum systems. In fact, not just that, even the complementarity aspect we will talk about. So communication, quantum communication is about leveraging probabilities for cryptography. Now, the second aspect of quantum technology, and the most famous one, is quantum computing. And quantum computing is to leverage correlations and the superposition states in order to create exponentially faster information processing. So it's a different application of some of these fundamental properties, namely in terms of algorithms or some computational tasks. And quantum computing has the promise that it can do certain tasks exponentially faster than normal computers. And exponentially faster is another way of saying basically that at some point, it's just impossible to do it any other way. So a normal computer just simply cannot do it, whereas a quantum computer records, if it's big enough, can do it in an instant. And then finally, another aspect of quantum technology development is what we know as quantum sensing. And that is to also leverage correlations between different systems, and in particular also the superposition states, so these unusual forms of existence, in order to increase precision of something that we want to measure. So it could be medical imaging, or it could be detecting very faint signals or faint light. And using these quantum correlations and superpositions can enhance the type of tools that we can use for much higher precision than would otherwise be possible. So that's the field of quantum sensing. Now, let me briefly just say a couple of applications. So these are the overarching different technology sectors, but the applications are very, very wide, at least once we have the systems up and running on a scale which is sufficiently large. So on the one hand, we can build simulators that use quantum mechanics in order to simulate some properties which are very complex. And so the promise there is that we can do materials discovery. Maybe we can predict chemical reactions, which would help for drug discovery, space research and development for novel materials and so forth. The sensors are very promising and in fact already up and running in many cases. They really help us for navigation, also extremely precise timing. So in fact, all our clocks, which are fundamentally doing things in the best possible way, even GPS, they all already are based on quantum sensors. You can try to look at faint signals, which are hard to detect otherwise, such as finding oil somewhere underneath the ground. Cryptography, of course, is an important aspect for banking and defense. Imaging, similarly, maybe there is some defense use, but most importantly, there's a lot of promise and hope that we can use it for much better medical imaging. And then the computing aspect is kind of the most exciting aspect of it, because it has extremely wide applications if it works at some point to control these systems, which are sufficiently large. And so the hope is to do machine learning exponentially fast, apply different algorithms for different type of mundane questions like portfolio optimizations or AI driving robotics and so forth. So there is a lot of potential of these systems, but we're just really at the very, very beginning of building and exploring these type of machines and devices. So let me just very briefly zoom into quantum computing. So this is really one of the most exciting fields, which is gaining a lot of momentum in recent years. So probably as many of you heard, there's a lot of development both in the private sector and also in academia in this field. It has been not that much interest in it for 20 years until a couple of years ago, except for in academia. So it's been driven very strongly academically from the 90s in the last maybe 20 years. But since a couple of years ago, there's been huge interest from the private sector, tremendous interest with millions and even billions invested into developing these technologies. Most famous, there's of course the Google quantum computer, the startups such as Rigetti and PsiQuantum, even now in the stock market, some of the companies. And then of course, there's still laboratories that are working. It's an exciting time because it's both an engineering question, it's also a funding question, but it's also a lot of basic research question. And so there's a lot that has to be done academically because there's still so much we don't know. And there's still so much to explore in order to try and understand these quantum devices. So I'll just say a couple of words on that. So the promise of quantum computing is not that it's actually faster, although that is a nice side effect. The promise of quantum computing is it's really conceptually different, just as a laser is different to a light bulb. Namely, it can perform certain tasks that just the normal computers cannot do. So you cannot apply a normal computer for just specific questions, but you can use a quantum computer to answer them. But it's only some very, very specialized specific questions for which it is good for. And there's only a few known examples of that. The most famous one is due to Peter Shor from the 90s. And that is that we know that a quantum computer, if it works at the large scale, can factorize numbers very efficiently. And that's a typical example of where we assume a classical normal computer can never be able to do. And nearly all of our cryptography is based on this premise that we cannot factorize numbers efficiently. but a quantum computer can. And so once it's built, one signature is that, you know, all Bitcoin wallets will be emptied because you can just immediately crack any such mathematical problem. So you have to develop novel cryptography concepts and algorithms that are also secure against this number factorization. But there are some other examples where quantum computers we know can have a tremendous impact. One is to search databases. So that can be done much faster than normal computers can do. And it has a lot of practical applications. And even more so, it can solve so-called systems of linear equations, specific aspects of them, quite efficiently, which a classical computer cannot do with their large. And this has many applications, such as, you know, in stock markets or in other fields. So why is it possible that quantum computers can do something which is conceptually different? And it goes back to the fact that quantum mechanics is built on premises which are conceptually different. So you are leveraging some of these unique features, and that's why you get also these unique outcomes which are not possible otherwise with just normal systems. And one of the features you leverage is that you can have these superpositions. So if you have information carriers, so if you encode information, you don't just encode it in specific possible ways, but you also leverage the possibility of encoding it in superpositions. So it's kind of a broader class of what I call forms of existence. And so you have much more ways to encode information in one and the same system. So for example, in polarization, it's not just vertical, horizontal, but you can also use these circularly polarized states. So it broadens the class of how you can encode information in using still a single system. And at the same time, if you combine many of them, they can be correlated through this entanglement. And this correlation is also what enables this possibility of computing, because it really correlates a lot of these information carriers such that they can parallelize some of these computational tasks between each other, which would not be possible otherwise with kind of according to normal algorithmic theory. So these computational tasks that we do on a quantum computer are encoded in operation of what we call qubits. So these are just basic building blocks which obey quantum mechanics. And this is just simply to say that they can be in superpositions of states. And the outcomes of a quantum computer are also always quantum states. And so recall that quantum mechanics is always probabilistic. So in fact, a quantum computer is also always probabilistic. So it doesn't just give us a single answer, but it gives us an answer with some probability. And then we have to measure it and run it many times in order to get the probabilities right. And so one example is, you know, where we have running quantum computers that work, but for example, it can factorize or multiply, you know, it can factorize the number 15 and show us with some probability of 60% that this number is 3 times 5. So these are baby steps, but this was a couple of years ago, and we've come actually a very, very long way since then. But these are showing proof of principle of these operations in this novel paradigm of computation. Now, so what's the state of the art? And this is one of the last things I want to mention. So in some sense, to give you an analogy, we're really at the very, very beginning of this development of quantum technologies, especially quantum computing. For example, the current limit of qubits, how many we can entangle, is 256, very recently, a month ago or so, coming out of Harvard. And so currently we can have 300 qubits or so. And that's maybe analogous to where computing was something like 80, 90 years ago, where you had these gigantic devices just simply to have very, very very, very few bits that we process instead of, you know, a gigabit or so. And so this is where we are today with the current devices. At the same time, it needs extreme physical conditions to operate. And that is because quantum phenomena are so fragile. So currently, most of the systems operate at below 270 degrees. So they have to be extremely cooled. And one of the analogies is maybe these early transistors, which were these bulky, complicated systems. And then later we learned how to miniaturize them and build billions of them on a single chip. And most importantly, and for me, most interesting as a theorist and thinking about concepts, is there's only very, very few algorithms that we know which are actually useful for quantum computing. So you're not going to play computer games on a quantum computer because it's a specialist device, specialized, a little bit like a laser. And so one of the challenges is also to understand what other possible applications such systems could have. Those that we know are very powerful, but we don't know how far it can go. We don't know what else is even possible with these systems. So that's a lot of basic research there. Okay, so what are the challenges? Why is it so hard to build it? Like I said, quantum information is very fragile. And this is the decoherence I talked about. If we interact and build bigger system, they very, very quickly decay away from these special quantum states into mundane, everyday expected behavior. And so there's other aspects such imprecise control and that systems are noisy and it's hard to build it engineering-wise. And a lot of hardware improvement may even require basic science because it's uncharted territory. So we're building bigger devices, but who knows what kind of obstacles might be coming there. So it's an interplay between academia and private sector right now to really explore this uncharted area in the coming decades. And finally, we don't know the full potential of quantum computing, especially. So some practical algorithms we know, but what we also don't know is if we have these systems which are still noisy and currently maybe available, or even now, we don't know what we can do with them, which could be really advantages. There's a lot of research going on in this direction. Okay, and finally, this is my last slide. That's most exciting for us as researchers. There's also a lot of open questions in quantum mechanics about basic science. We're still, in my view, at the very beginning of even understanding nature and fundamental concepts behind it. All we know is that it cannot be so simple and nice as we expected it to be 100 years ago. So it has to be weird. And how more weird even than what we know today, I think only time can tell. But the frontiers that we're exploring currently in basic science is, can we see these quantum effects at large scales, human scales? Can we push the limits of quantum behavior to ever larger and bigger and more massive systems, such that we can even see with our human eyes? And there's a lot of development in that, even at Stockholm University, including Mohamed's lab, who just introduced me in the beginning of the lecture. Other questions are, what about life or even consciousness or just biology in general? What does it mean if biological systems also experience this kind of quantum effects? Can we even create them in a biological setting? Do they matter? Maybe they give some enhancements. And there is actually indication that maybe quantum effects are leveraged in biology for improved sensing, for example. And so this is also something we're trying to understand. We don't have definite answers. And then finally, we can zoom out fully. What we completely don't understand is how gravity fits into this whole picture. Does it change some of this quantum behavior or vice versa? Does everyday scales, do they somehow depend on quantum behavior? And that's really a lot that people have thought about for decades and we don't have good solutions. And now we're trying to use quantum technologies to answer some of those questions. Okay, and with that, I just briefly want to summarize. My take-home message is that quantum mechanics is weird because it has counterintuitive predictions. It is not something we usually experience. But they all have been confirmed. All of these things I've been talking about now and every prediction of quantum mechanics have been confirmed to extremely high precision over and over again in different aspects. It's very hard to control these effects, but we are starting to become feasible. And now we can turn it around, build technology. And some of these technologies is commercially available, like cryptography, even sensors. And others maybe take years or even decades to fully mature, but they will have tremendous impact, such as quantum computing. And then there's a lot of open questions. Is there something beyond quantum theory? Maybe. Is there something that limits quantum theory? Maybe. I don't think so. And we just don't know. There's still a lot to explore. But with that, I thank you for tuning in and your attention. And I hope to have excited you a little bit about quantum physics. And we're open for questions.
Okay. Tack. Igor för excellent föreläsning. Och nu börjar jag med frågor. Man kan fråga direkt eller med chat. You can ask questions now and directly to Igor or you just write on the chat their questions and then we can ask Igor about it.
Okay, yeah. I have a question here.
Yes, please, yes.
A little bit about the quantum computing.
Yes.
And how general is this with the different qubits, like 256 qubits and so on, do they have to be configured differently for the different tasks, or is it general and just programmed?
That's an excellent question, a very, very good question. And it goes to the core of where we are today. This is, I think, what we distinguish between quantum computers and quantum simulators. So the simulators would be to use these qubits, which are not general, and they will configure it for a specific task. And this task could be very important, like drug discovery, some specific things, but it's not programmable. So that would be like a simulator. We do have quantum computers where they're configurable, so we can program it to do different tasks. So that's where we are today with these 256. So we can program them, so they can perform different tasks to some limit, because the limit is they're not perfectly controllable, all of them. They're not perfectly connected with each other, which they would be in the idealized case. So currently they're at a state where they're a little bit noisy, maybe we can control many of them at the same time, not fast enough, but it is a programmable computer. So it can do some things, but there's still a step towards being obviously universal in the sense that it can do anything we want. That's still more engineering.
Yeah. About the more fundamental questions about quantum and so on, can you say something about Bohmian mechanics and so on, or are there other theories like that? Is there any progress in science about them?
Yeah, that's also a very good question. There's two classes of these type of research direction. One is which we call interpretations of quantum mechanics, and that is trying to make sense of these strange behaviors. And Bohmian mechanics is one way of thinking about it, which is a little bit different from, let's say, the orthodox way to think about it. And it has a slightly different, what we call ontology. So a slightly different assumption about what the fundamental building blocks of nature are, in some sense. But the important thing about Bohmian mechanics, why we call it interpretation, and other interpretations, there's many, I don't know, many worlds, or you know, there's all these competing things, they all make the same predictions. So it's more of a philosophical question of how we best kind of, what do we elevate as our fundamental concepts in the theory, but the predictions are all the same. So in principle, we don't know of a way how to distinguish these different things, how to distinguish it. One drawback of Bohmian mechanics and why it's becoming less popular is because it's hard to think of the way Bohmian mechanics thinks of quantum mechanics, to think about relativistic quantum mechanics. So quantum field theory, so other kind of, when we take Einstein's special relativity into account, Bohmian mechanics becomes very difficult to square it with that.
So but it doesn't mean it's impossible. Progress, no progress there.
There's not much. There's a little bit people are attempting, but there's not that much in that sense. But again, we don't know experiments that could distinguish them. But the second class, it could be, yeah, and that's, I think that fits with your question, maybe also what you're thinking is, there are ideas that maybe there's something different about quantum mechanics at some scale, so some modification, so something that we're maybe missing about the theory. And there are these type of models or theories or speculations make predictions that we can test experimentally. So Mohamed can run an experiment and test if it's true. So there is, and these are not simply interpretations of quantum mechanics, although they also change the ontology, but they also make predictions which are then really testable. And that is very fruitful because then we can really do experiments and see if that's true. So some, for example, fundamentally postulate that this superposition principle maybe breaks down at some scale. And we can test for that. It's hard, but at least it makes predictions which are different. And in this class, there's a lot of development in this direction, especially experimentally, because we are having much more tools now available to test these things. So there's still a lot of research on these fundamental aspects of quantum mechanics. It's really the final story.
Thank you, Igor.
Thank you.
We have now the quantum technology that is coming, and you mentioned application in daily life, right? And then one, what about this technology or this device or this understanding of quantum can help us to enter the untested nor universe better, or to get some insight that we couldn't get in the past, you know, about cosmology or about astrophysics or astrophysic physics or something like that. What could this new technology or this new view of quantum theory to help us to understanding these things, you know? Yes.
Yeah, thanks for this question. It's a very exciting question. It's kind of at the heart of the frontier of physics right now.
Yes.
And I think there's two directions also here that is being explored, somewhat complementary. One is once we build better devices, better sensors, and just more sensitive systems, such as atomic clocks that are super sensitive, or you know these sensors that use entanglement, we can just use them to try and measure some of these fundamental questions, like the searching dark matter that we don't know if it exists or not and in what form. Or we can try to measure gravitational waves with the systems or some cosmological signatures. And they give us better precision, and it gives us just much better ways to explore these completely open fundamental questions in modern science. So I think they open a lot of possibilities there alone. So that alone is interesting. Mm-hmm. And then the second part is there is another layer to it, which I think is extremely exciting. Namely, this, what I just said, is it's just a better tool. It's still very exciting, but it's a better tool. But there's another layer, namely, there's maybe some interplay between some of these fundamental open questions, like dark matter or gravity, that changes the behavior of these quantum technological devices. Because this quantum technology uses quantum properties in the first place. And the question how they are affected by some of these fundamental forces and unknown speculative models, they will change a little bit how these quantum devices operate. And so that alone will also either put some limits on these quantum devices, or it will change some behavior which wouldn't be visible with just normal tools. So if you just use normal tools that don't operate with these quantum systems, no matter how precise they are, we might never be able to kind of see this interplay. And so this interface between possible new physics or gravity or other effects with these quantum devices, I think is a very, very exciting frontier of physics. And we have some ideas, in terms of as a community, where we can start probing things. So if we have bigger and bigger quantum computers and cryptography and sensors, that they will start seeing some effects that are not yet visible. But I think there's still a lot to explore there. So it's a very exciting research.
And then another following this, are the data theory developed like now, this quantum information theory, as a theory could have, could be mapped to some other physical or something like that? Like now people are using these tools for condensed matter theory. Like could this tool developed, like mathematical tools now developed in this theory, could be mapped to be used for other physics or chemistry or something, or other contestant or something like that?
I think so. It's a good question. I'm not an expert, but you're right. I think there's a lot of open questions. Just to give one example, where to support what you're saying, for example, just commercially, if you look at where is a lot of money in quantum computing today, it is actually going into the direction what you're saying, so-called quantum-inspired classical solutions.
Yeah.
Namely, we have this other way of thinking about things, and even without quantum mechanics, it opens novel possibilities. We have no mathematical techniques. We think about things just from a different perspective. Yes. And even without quantum mechanics, bringing that mindset back into what we know can open a lot of possibilities. And so, for example, Microsoft is very big on this, quantum-inspired classical solutions. And they claim, and others too, that it does give you actually a lot of enhancement. For example, novel algorithmic techniques that we didn't think of before, even though there was no fundamental reason why we couldn't, but just because we changed our mindset, it opened new ways of thinking about it. So I think there's a lot of this also in fundamental physics true to be found.
Okay, I think it's very exciting, really. Are more questions from the people here? Or I mean, as Igor said, then you can see that you can reach Igor by his name, and then you can write in Google. You found his email and his contact. Then you can always contact Igor by email, and I'm sure that he would be more than happy to answer to your questions. Right? There are no more questions or something like that. Yeah. Otherwise, I'd like to thank Igor for his today and lecture and answering to the questions and comments. I also like thank the audience to be here with us, and I wish to see you in November. We have our next lecture. Hopefully we try to have it at physically, like at Albanova, if this regulation allowed, but I think that's the plan. And I see you soon. Okay, thank you for everybody. Thank you for Igor. Yeah, and see you later. Yeah. Thanks to everybody. Okay, bye-bye. Bye.